On Friday, January the 5th, 1962, at Kingston Airport, Jamaica, cinematic history was made as the cameras rolled on the first scene of Dr. No, featuring the then little-known gentleman spy James Bond 007. 30 years and 16 films later, on Saturday, September 26, 1992, 100 members of the James Bond 007 fan club gathered at Pinewood Studios to celebrate 30 years of James Bond in the cinema. Organised by the club in conjunction with Dave Worrell's James Bond Collectors Club, fans were able to meet other fans and purchase a myriad of Bond memorabilia, from photos to the odd toy, as well as having the chance to mingle and talk with the likes of Commander Ken Wallis and special effects man Burt Luxford, stunt coordinators Paul Weston and George Leech, production designers Peter Lamont and the ever jovial Syd Cain. Q himself, Desmond Llewelyn, was on hand, as well as the lovely Madeline Smith, Miss Caruso from Live and Let Die, and special effects director Derek Meddings. Club president Graham Rice started the day's proceedings.
To the James Bond 30th birthday party, and once again I'm very pleased that so many of you have given your support to our event, because without you there wouldn't be any event. I'm sure that no one working on Dr. No 30 years ago ever thought that that film would create such a phenomenon that's lasted so many years, and I don't suppose for one moment that they thought that there was going to be a group of us here today celebrating that fact. Also, I'm particularly pleased today to welcome a number of club members from around the world, and we've got people here today from Sweden, Holland, France, Germany, Italy and America. So I'm sure you'll all make everybody welcome and make sure everybody else has a nice day. I'll now hand you over to Dave Worrell.
We're on a very tight schedule today. The weather's fine for us, so it's looking good. Everything's run very smoothly in the organisation. The only thing that was a little bit disappointed this week, that Caroline Munro isn't unable to come today. She's on a filming schedule this weekend. But the good news is that we've got Miss Caruso for you from Living at Dine, which is the actress Madeline Smith. She'll be coming along to sign autographs around about 2:30 to 3:00 this afternoon.
The first surprise of the day was an exclusive.
Well, I wish the fan club as great as successful party, and all my love to all of them there. I wish I was there, but I don't think I can be at the moment.
I'd like to take this these few moments just to address all of you that are attending the 30th birthday of James Bond, and to tell you that without you people, without the fan club and the fans around the world for cinema, and especially the James Bond series, that there wouldn't be any James Bond series. It's all of you who, with your enthusiasm and your support, your excitement for the films that come out and for the characters, that help feed the work we do, because as you know, the film media is isolated as opposed to theater, so we don't get immediate feedback or connection with the audience. So it's particularly enjoyable for me to be able to address some of you today out there that share in the tradition of Bond. I'd also like to take this moment to just say how I think important it is for the continued support you all give to Graham Rye in running your fan club, and how much it's appreciated, I know, by the Broccolis, because I've had conversations with them, and with the other members of the James Bond family, which you're all a part of. So, I can't thank you enough, and I think we should sing a happy birthday, not only to the 30th anniversary of James Bond, but to all of you people that are part of this club.
The 30th James Bond Club, you wonderful fans, you've been our supporters for so many years and you keep going. I hope you have a very happy birthday, and if I were only here, I would be so pleased to join you. And thank you. Bye.
Hi, my name's Gilbert, Lewis Gilbert. I hope you know what that means. I'm sure you do, being the fan club. I'm so sorry that I can't be with you because I'm aboard at the moment. But do ask me again because I'd love to come and meet you all. So have a good day at Pinewood. All the best.
Hi, my name's Moore. Roger Moore, yeah, no. No, hi, I'm Roger Moore. And I would like to say thank you to all the James Bond fans that like my James Bond. You're all terrific. Your support has helped make the series a success for 30 years. And may it go on for another 30. But your enthusiasm go on forever. Have a nice evening.
Because they're showing Dr. No and Terence is going.
Oh, in London?
It's in London. It's at Pinewood. It's on the 26th of September that they're going.
Oh, I'll still be filming here.
So you will still be filming, but Terence is going and they're screening Dr.
Okay,
No.
Well, I'll send it and Terence can convey it to them all.
Yes.
It's a wonderful 30th. It just makes it impossible for me to lie about my age. But I hope you all have a terrific evening and I'll speak to you soon, Terence. Good night and thank you.
Outside in the Pinewood Garden stood the most famous car in the world, surrounded by some of the vehicles used by the most famous spy in the world. The BD jet from Octopussy, the Aston Martin Volante used by Timothy Dalton in his first outing as Bond, and everybody's favourite, Little Nellie. Also on display was the Yamaha stunt bike used by Eddie Kidd in the unseen sequence from The Living Daylights. The Aston Martin DB5 was a fully operational mock-up and was kindly loaned to the club for the day by Peter Nelson, who owns the Cars of the Stars Museum in Kendal, Cumbria. Miraculously intact from its self-detonated destruction in The Living Daylights, the Aston Martin Volante proved to be quite a crowd puller, as fans were eager to pose for photographs by the shining machine. The BD Jet also had its fair share of admirers, but the most popular car by far was the DB5. I asked veteran special effects men Burt Luxford and Joe Fitt, who were joined by Commander Ken Wallis, what was the most difficult effect they had to do on a Bond movie?
Well, I think obviously the car was one of the most difficult effects, you know, because In those days, we hadn't got the things like microstick chips and things like this to help us. Everything had to be done by, shall we say, remote control, cables and all that sort of thing, you know, of course, which took up a lot of room in the car.
Yeah, well, being a prototype, then most of it was done with a little bit of hydraulic and electric.
Yeah, hydraulics, of course, were in it, as Joe says. Electronics were very seldom used in those days.
12-volt battery operated, not a little micro.
The guns, of course, were not blanks, as people think they are. They were done, again, a rig which was very much big. I mean, we could have used, I mean, Joe can would admit to this, being a firearms man, we could have used a real gun easier than we could have done the the models that we used. Yeah. They were fired by an irregular mixture of gases.
When we did fire, we put a smizers through the hole.
Yeah, that's right. Put the
smizers through the hole. Fired the blanks.
Yeah.
Did you get any help from Aston Martin?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Tremendous amount of cooperation from Aston's. Yeah. I mean, they couldn't help us with the effects, as everybody knows, because it wasn't their job. But I mean, one day, Joe probably remember this, because Ken at the time wasn't here. He was still working his aircraft. But we did the first shot of the film after putting all these lovely gimmicks on the car, spending thousands of pounds doing it. The first shot was taking the car straight through a brick wall. In the studios here. And of course the thing had to go back to, I mean the front was all dented. What I didn't tell the stunt driver was the fact there was a load of tubing behind there.
Yeah,
because he went straight through the wall, which is harmless, and went straight into the tubing.
12-inch angle arm.
It wasn't really funny from our point of view after that, all this work. And they took the car back the following day, not drivable of course, and I think they were only at it a week, and they had it back to us in spotless condition again. I mean, a very good diet.
Ken, pilot and designer of Little Nellie, did these gents help in the design?
Oh yes, yes. There were discussions after I'd done the first flight here when they suddenly decided they wanted it in Japan in 6 weeks' time with the cosmetics, and we discussed the ideas and so forth. I was an armament specialist in the RAF just prior to coming out and so on, so I obviously had certain vested interest. Also, I was going to have to acquire the weapons and so on, but we got on extremely well. I mean, I met it again, you know, suddenly in Japan. And
how about the first time when you tried it out on the
rocket?
All the Japanese come down and say, never
work. Oh, they were very difficult.
Never worked.
Yeah. They weren't very happy about flying around there. Sacred mountains.
Oh, one of them told me, said, this man is going to commit our car.
The car may have changed, but the firepower is just as awesome. With some added extras, like this handy little rocket booster, a must for fleeing enemy agents or just pulling away from the lights. All these wonderful modes of transport, lovingly designed and doted over in the films by that man who never jokes about his work, Q, played by Desmond Llewelyn. I asked Desmond if he was given any insight into the character of Q before filming commenced.
No, actually all that happened was in Goldfinger, that when we were rehearsing it, Sean comes in as Bond and I am working at a platform on some gadgets, and in the rehearsal I got up and Guy Hamilton said, no, you don't particularly notice this man because you don't like him. And I thought, you know, what the hell is he talking about? This is James Bond. And he said, no, I mean, he treats all your gadgets and everything with contempt, and so that is...
During the day, Desmond was presented with a copy of the most famous car in the world by the author himself, Dave Worrell. Desmond also happily posed for many photographs. Here he is with Peter Nelson from the Cars of the Stars Museum. And also, here he is with a rather tired-looking Graham Rye. Desmond is the longest-serving actor in the Bond movies, appearing in all but two, Dr. No and Live and Let Die, and is always a popular guest at the club's conventions. Another popular guest is production designer Syd Cain. Syd has worked on four Bond films, which include...
Dr. No, From Russia With Love, Live and Let Die, and On the Majesty's Secret Service.
Right, so I should imagine there was a bit of a difference between budget between Dr. No and On the Majesty.
Yes, I mean, we had hardly anything on Dr. No. I was art director, I wasn't production designer, Ken was production designer. I was art director on it, and I didn't get a credit. Dear old what's his name, left it off by accident.
Oh dear.
But it didn't matter because no. Cubby gave me a gold pen instead.
Oh. Wonderful story about From Russia with Love, the sequence with the rats.
Oh, the rats, yes, that's quite a story. We couldn't shoot them here. Well, we tried. We had tame rats, white rats, and we powdered them with cocoa. But under the heat of the lamps, they just sat down and licked it all off. So eventually we weren't allowed to use wild rats, so I had to go to Spain. And we did it in a big warehouse in Spain and had real sewer rats, which was quite something, hundreds of the things. But even they got a bit dozy under the heat, and we had to prop them with sticks and things to make them run. And then, of course, they all got out, they all got away, and Cubby was there and so on. He was the second one up on a chair.
Oh, right.
And I was the first.
Let Die, you had more fun with animals with the alligators in crocodiles,
please.
Crocodiles, was it?
Alligators are nothing, right. Tame compared to crocodiles. Yeah, that was quite fun. The last sequence where you see, in theory, Roger running across the backs of the crocodiles, of course, was done by the crocodile owner, Ross Kananga. That was quite fun because he'd never worn shoes before, and of course for that scene he had to wear shoes to look like Roger. So we had the shoes made to measure, and we put non-slip on the socks. And the crocodiles we tied down with weights, concrete weights, on their feet, tied, just to leave their head and tail free. And Ross tried it four times and fell off. And he said, now they're waiting for me. Apparently they're quite intelligent crocodiles. But anyway, even dear old Guy Hamilton, who was directing me, he said, well, no, that's enough. We're not, you know, it's too dangerous. But anyway, he went the fifth time and it worked.
Finally, Syd, the bobsleigh sequence on the Majesty's Secret Service. Now, is it true that you had to rebuild?
Yeah, we rebuilt the bobsleigh because the original one, which had been used for Winter Olympics many years earlier, wasn't fast enough, dangerous enough. So we had to build another one. And of course the big thing about that was that cameraman was marvellous, who went down on skis, you know.
That's right, ski backwards.
Oh, it was terrific, yeah, fabulous. All that sort was fun,
yeah,
great fun.
Would you work on another one, Syd?
Would I?
Yeah.
Oh, of course, I'd work on anything.
All right, Syd Cain, thanks very much for giving up your time today.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
It was now time for the eagerly awaited tour of Pinewood Studios, hosted by Dave Wall, an absolute mine of information when it comes to the antics of Mr. Bond. With some club officials taking a working lunch, the first stop was to be the gardens behind the main house, looking quite normal today.
But in From Russia with Love, when the helicopter arrives at Spectre headquarters on the supposedly island, that is here. The helicopter landed here on the lawn, all the lights came on the house, the Sean Connery, the pre-credit sequence. The Gatsby suite wasn't there in those days. That was built there for the Great Gatsby movie. It's been there ever since. The house has also featured predominantly in Who Dares Wins. It was the American Embassy. Carry On of the Khyber. That was filmed here. The sequence where they're storming the house at the end, and all this area here and on the front was all covered with sand and gravel. And it was meant to be out in wherever the Khyber is. So, just to show you how clever the Bond people were and very effective with their special effects, the sequence in Golfing, you'll remember, obviously, when Oddjob throws the bowler hats. That was filmed at Stoke Pogey's Golf Club, which is about 3 miles away from here. It's filmed the sequence where he actually chopped off the head of the statue. There wasn't a statue at the golf club. There it is over there. And it literally is, if you look at your video, you'll see that archway in the background. Everything's exactly the same, and that's where it was filmed. It just shows you how filming can be, just for those one little insert, back to the studio and shoot it with a plaster statue. If we're going, while we're going on the tour, if you want to take any photographs, just by all means do, just stop me and do what you want. We're going to Take a walk up to the hedgerow. Pre-title sequence where Sean Connery filmed, obviously he's supposed to be the double, was all filmed here where he was stalked by the killer with the watch, with the garrote. And that was all shot here, right down to the statue down by the fountain at the far end. So if you want to take any photographs, this is the area where they were all filmed. They did actually put false hedges in as well to make them look closer together. But these were the basis of those. If we go further up, I'll pinpoint some more interesting. The sequence here, the camera points is from where you're standing. But Rosa Klebb comes for the first time. And over there by the pool is Red Grant. And he's having this massage by this lovely, sexy blonde. Red Grant comes up to where you are and gets punched in the stomach. I have a nice little surprise for you today, because that lady that did actually massage him, we have us with us today. Jan Williams, the actress, is here somewhere. Here she comes.
Hi. Hi, everybody. Surprise, surprise.
Is everybody looking just as lovely as you? Well, we couldn't
and
persuade.
And there's no massaging today, okay? I know what you're going to say.
She hasn't got a bikini on underneath it. I wish she had, but she hasn't. So we're going to go by the pool. If anybody wants to take some photos with Jan, by all means. Autographs, can you leave till we get back to the house because of running out of time? But let's go over to the spot where she did her bit.
Yeah, Robert, sure.
Many fans were eager to have their photograph taken with Jan. Who wouldn't? It was also in this part of the garden where the end sequence of Goldfinger was filmed, where Bond gets down to some serious undercover work with Pussy Galore.
Now we're going to go over to the paddock tank where they shoot model work on the back lot. Now they are filming today, they're filming Frankenstein actually over there, it's the last shots. So if they're actually shooting, then we just have to stop, wait for them to do it, and then we can go down there, they don't mind. As we walk down there, you'll see on your left, there's lots of large bells. They are the cathedral bells from the Gotham City at the end of Batman, where they have the battle and they all come tumbling down. They're all there on the left. You'll see a cage and there's all plaster rocks. You'll see lots of giant chess figures which appeared in Scaramanga's funhouse in The Man with the Golden Gun. So they're on your left as we're going down to the tank. Right, let's go to Goldfinger, the sequence where Connery's driving the DB5 and he's been caught and he's escorted by the two Mercedes. And he comes to the factory. You're standing right by where the gates were with the old lady with the machine gun. That was built here, the house. And it went across here. The plaster shops weren't there then. This is all lawned right back to the sound stages here. But he literally shut up this road, and where all those no parking signs are there, the car stopped and he ejected out the Korean guard or the bag of cement, whatever they used. That was shot there. So you're standing in a piece of history at the moment.
From here, Dave took the group on a tour of the roads and alleyways of Pinewood Studios, that doubled for Goldfinger's smelting plant back in 1964, and where the first DB5 came to an undignified end. The fans then made their way towards the famous 007 stage, the highlight of the tour for most. But before entering this cavernous building, yet another surprise had been planned. Standing outside the unglamorously named Prop Shed 7 was production designer Peter Lamont. But what props lay hidden in Shed 7?
Most of the stuff that's laying in here is from Living Daylights. Like, there's three Aston Martins there, two have got engines, the other is a complete one other than it's engineless. There are some fiberglass shells in there, because obviously we can't buy enough cars to suffice all the requirements of the film. Actually, when they were being built, we had like a production line down on the North Dock stage, and it did almost look like Aston Martin's factory. That other thing you can see just inside the door is the sledge on which the pig lay when we did Living Daylights. It's in a bit of disarray because the last film we did here was obviously in late kind of 1987, and when we did License to Kill, we all went off to Mexico, so we didn't take any of the props with us. We got everything there in Mexico, and then we came back here, and the odd bits and pieces that came back, they just lay in there until such time as hopefully we do on 17.
The giant 007 stage was built to house the interior of Stromberg's supertanker in The Spy Who Loved Me. But even this wasn't big enough for three real nuclear subs.
If we had done them full size, we'd have only got two, and they would have stuck way out the other end, because they are somewhat big. Also, they would have gone up through the roof, because they are 33 feet in diameter, the sail was probably another 30, 40 feet, and it would have been not possible. Anyway, we had to scale them down to get them in. They were built in situ by a company called IESA from Whitewater. They were the constructors. The art department provided the drawings. We had railway lines laid in the bottom of the tank. They then came in, built their metal structure, and then clad them with reinforced fiberglass. Unfortunately, during our shooting, we did blow a hole in the roof when the globe blew up. The special effects, they were doing their bit where Bron blows the big door into the set, but unfortunately got out a bit out of hand and went through the roof. But the only funny thing is with that, there was this fire, we had to get rid of everybody. And being one of the interested parties, as soon as the fire was under control, obviously I went up to the control room, which is the set where it got burnt, to find out what damage there was, because we were right in the heart of shooting. And we did have banks of television monitors, and it's funny, during that, the fire, we had six pinched, and also the projectors out of the globe. Now, nobody knows how people got in and out, but they did. When we did Octopussy, it was viable because we had the fort in here with a balloon and all those parts that we couldn't freely do in India. But at that time we did have a problem. It was winter. We did have a big cyclorama backing way around the other end, which was painted as sky. And every morning when we came in, there were always lines down, and I could never make out what it was. Well, we used to have a terrible condensation problem because it was only a single skin roof. Anyway, we came then to do View to a Kill, and there was a slight problem because Ridley Scott had got this stage with Legend, and one famous day it caught fire, and I was sitting in my office, smoke came past the window, and I thought, there's either a big bonfire or the 07 stage is on fire. Lo and behold, it was this place looking like the Hindenburg. But that afternoon I went to see Covey and said, look, we've either got to recut our cloth and kind of come up with a whole new concept, or do you really want to see the stage rebuilt? And he said, yeah, I want to see it rebuilt.
And it was rebuilt, and opened in time to shoot the mine sequence in A View to a Kill. The tour now moved on to the back lot. Dave continues.
Right, the road that you've just walked along, that was Gotham City from the first Batman film. And also the same area was used when they built the huge big American town for Supergirl. So quite a lot of this area is used extensively. Bond-wise, the most important thing, the most fascinating thing for me was they built Fort Knox here, as you all know. And you see the way the tarmac goes and just disappears into the grass. That is Gold Vault Road. And the Fort Knox was in that area there. That square was built right there. They built the road right out into the park. They got permission off the local council, took the fence down, and they built it right out. So when you see the sequence with the trucks turning the corner in the woods and going down, that was actually in the park, and it really was here and nowhere else. Another fascinating point, and I didn't know until about 2 years ago, was in the same film, Goldfinger's Stud Farm, that was built on the back lot as well. I mean, I was convinced that was shot on location, but it wasn't. And it's built just the same. It's built in the same place as where Fort Knox was, so obviously one had to come down to build the other. And the ranch was here, and that filled the whole lot area. So, I mean, it was a terrific set when you think about it, what it was, and amazed me. A little interesting item, Octopussy at the beginning, where when Bond comes down in the small jet and he pulls up outside the garage and says, fill her up. That's filmed just over there. They just built the garage and filmed that one sequence there. I don't know why they didn't film it on the location, but that's James Bond for you. View to a Kill, the huge bridge sequence at the end where they're fighting, that was built over there and just filmed against the natural sky. And the living daylights when the bridge goes up at the very end, although they did use a forced perspective model on the real location in Morocco, they did close-ups on a huge model, which is about the height of a house, and that's filmed on the back lot over there. And that's about it.
Back in the garden, Desmond was busy signing autographs. And signing autographs. And signing autographs. And guess what stunt coordinator on the latest Bond films Paul Weston was doing? You've got it, signing autographs. Madeline Smith, who stepped in at the last moment, proved to be a big hit with the fans, happy to sign autographs as well as ask the odd question of her own.
Interesting. I think most men would say that. I don't know how it is from a woman's point of view. I go for the quality of the film, yes. But I think a lot of men like Sean Weston. Interesting.
I asked Madeline what were her other interests apart from acting.
Boys' books and boys' films. I've just discovered a marvellous lady thriller writer called Sue Grafton, and I'm devouring it. She's written things like A for Alibi, and she works her way through the alphabet. They're fantastic. They're American. I love stuff like that.
Would she like to play a female detective or a private investigator?
I would love it. I'd love it. I would give anything. I like best of all to play villains and villainesses. I actually played a murderess. London Weekend Television about 10 years ago did an Agatha Christie called Why Didn't They Ask Evans? And I was in, and I was the villainess. It was wonderful.
You enjoyed that.
I actually did the murder. And I had to play a total loony. It was great. Moira, her name was, wasn't it? She appeared to be a real weed, and underneath it she was like, cow. Lovely parts. I'm sick of playing wimps.
Studio 7 was the next location, where club members were treated to a special screening of Dr. No. Andrew Pilkington, the club's vice president and secretary, takes up the story.
What we've now got is a print of Dr. No. It's print number 172. It's not an original, it wasn't made in 62, it was made in 74. Unfortunately, it's not as good as we'd like it to be, so I'm afraid you'll have to bear with us with the blips and the humps and the cuts, etc. There are a few jolts in it, I'm afraid, but it is nice to see it, A, in 35mm, and seeing it as opposed to not seeing it at all. You know, we thought that with this birthday party, we really had to screen the film come what may. So this is the best print that is available in this country. To do a new print costs £2,000. We haven't got £2,000. If we had, we'd have got one made. But anyway, we hope you enjoy it. A couple of hours' time, we'll be out in the restaurant again. But hope you enjoy Dr. No. Thank you.
It's quite amazing to think that when this film was originally released, one newspaper dismissed the film as a dangerous mixture of violence, vulgarity, sadism, and sex. Little were they to know what an impact this and the other 15 films in the series were to make on the history of the cinema. As the fans enjoyed an hour or so of pure escapism, the guests were out in the garden for a photo call. Madeline Smith and George Leech, Commander Ken Wallis and Desmond Llewelyn. Unit manager on many of the Bond films, Iris Rose, Peter Nelson, and production designer Syd Cain. Mr. and Mrs. Dave Worrell, Lee Flint, the club's treasurer, and the man with the biggest headache of the day, club president Graham Rye. And Derek Meddings and club official Lance Narayan. It was during this short breather during the day that I chatted with a few of the guests, starting off with special effects expert Derek Meddings. What had been his favourite Bond film to work on?
I enjoyed doing Spy Who Loved Me, the super tanker, because that was great fun going to the Bahamas and all the diving. And Moonraker, I think, because there was a lot of effects on that. And yeah.
Which one would you say gave you the most problems?
Moonraker. The thing with Moonraker was that it was science fact and not science fiction. And the Americans hadn't launched one of the shuttles at that particular time. So what I was having to do was have to get all the information I could and then do the shot of the Moonraker shuttle taking off so that it looked exactly like it would do if the Americans had actually launched theirs. And I think at the end of the film they asked Tuck Cubby if he would let them have some of the footage because they were so impressed with it. They wanted to show it to all their employees to try and sort of boost their morale, because I think at this time they were beginning to get a bit, you know, down in the mouth over the fact that they hadn't launched theirs.
Did you have problems because it was being shot in France? Did any effects work have to go over France?
A lot of effects, the floor effects were done in France,
yeah,
but all the miniatures were shot here. I did them all here at Pinewood.
Right.
No, we just had to make certain that I had all the, you know, the information I needed, and that everything matched. But I mean, it doesn't really matter where it's being shot, as long as you tie up with a director and everybody.
The thing that sort of we got out of today is there's a lot of sort of teamwork on a Bond film. Did you find this, each department working together?
Well, that's what it's like on most films, and when there isn't teamwork, I think that's when the film suffers. But certainly on the Bond films, it was like one big happy family. And as you've gathered, you know, from the crowd here today, we've all been mates, and everybody enjoyed doing it. They were fun films to work on. Well, certainly the five I worked on. I really enjoyed it. And Cubby always looked after us and put us in the best hotels, and we flew first class and went to some fantastic countries.
Lived the life of James Bond almost yourself there.
Nearly, yeah.
Joining me next was George Leech and Paul Weston.
I've worked on several of the Roger Moore movies and coordinated on the last two Timothy Dalton ones. But all of them have obviously had tremendous stunts, and George has been in since Doctor No, which is on the first one. Octopussy, obviously all the train stuff, and doubling for Roger, and then with Timothy doing all the tanker stuff on the last one, and the fire jobs he did.
So George, you've been in there right at the beginning.
Yeah, right from Doctor No.
Yeah, what's been one of your most hairiest moments?
Well, they're all pretty hairy, but you know, you try to make them as safe as you can possibly do. But there's a lot of romance in it, as far as the actual film. Well, the film locations is always very a romantic place, and of course you have the lovely women around you too, which glamorizes everything. Not that you dare touch, but look. But the stunts are, of course, obviously the most exciting, the big stunts. But there's a lot of bread and butter stunts, we call fight scenes, and I should think probably 90% of the stunt work that you do is in actual fights, hand-to-hand combat, judo, all sorts of fight scenes, and you've got to make them look as realistic and as powerful as possible.
You can turn a tanker over, or you blow up a building, that's one thing, but to the people, the audience can relate more to Bond being in the physical contact situation. And there, I think you remember the fights inside the lift or inside the train with Jaws. They're much more personalised stunts. And we enjoy doing those because they're more physical for us to do.
Yeah.
We can, leap out the way of cars and buildings and things. But, to have physical contact is always more special for us, and I think for the audience.
One thing we've learned today is there's a lot of teamwork. So I imagine you work very closely with the art department and special effects and things like that.
Yeah, it's most essential to work with the art department because they can tell you what sort of a set you're going to have. And if you arrange a fight, you can use the various props that are around. And if you want anything special, anything extra, they will provide it. Until you've seen the set, or even if the set isn't ready, they will draw it out for you and explain what the set's going to be. And you can dream up a fight scene, a basic outline, before the set's ready.
And special effects, you have to rely on them to not actually blow you up, but to give enough impetus from behind for you to be able to do your explosion and make it look authentic. Also, and something like when I was doubling for Roger on Octopussy, sliding down the banisters, and at the end of the banisters there was this big lump of plaster which looked like a coconut or a pineapple. And if they hadn't have blown it off at the exact moment, I could have been doubling for all the women from then on. So we do rely on each other, and we rely on their timing and judgment as much as we do on each other when we are working closely together. So it is a team, it is teamwork, and we do work very closely with most departments.
Okay, and have you enjoyed yourself today?
Yes.
Wonderful, yeah.
Wonderful people to meet, and the fan club, and all the actors that are in special effects that are involved in it. And of course, the beautiful weather, look at it.
Wonderful, yeah. It's amazing how we're talking about films, and we're talking about 30 years of interest. It's amazing,
incredible,
isn't it?
How the time's flown.
Yeah.
I mean, Paul talking about cooperation between our own group of stuntmen. It's also between, say, Sean Connery, or the actors, Roger Moore, Tim Dalton. They know that they are working with experienced stuntmen, and they're always going to be safe doing what they're doing. They're not going to get their noses broken or their arms broken. They know that the scene is going to involve a lot of violence, and it's going to look good, and they're going to be safe. And the thing's going to be done very quickly and safely.
And look spectacular on screen. Gents, thanks very much. Thanks.
Pleasure.
Even the day's organisers found time for a quick chimwag. When did the day's activity begin for them?
It was 7 o'clock for me. It was 7.30 for Graham.
How's it gone?
I think it's gone excellent. In fact, we haven't had any problems at all, have we?
Touch wood.
Yeah. Still got the dinner to go, but no problems.
It's been a great turnout, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's been
I
excellent.
Think it has, actually. Everybody supported us very well. And I think everybody's had a really, really nice time, which is what it's all about.
Excellent. And you're both pleased with what's gone on today?
Very pleased. I mean, the one thing we were worried about yesterday while we were setting up, the weather was awful.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's absolutely fantastic today. And somebody at Eon Productions said, every time we come here and put an event on, the weather's superb. Yeah. Can we come more often? So prepared to pay us. Yes, we will.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
That would be nice.
Question that everyone must be asking. When's the next one?
Oh my God.
He always says, never say. No, you always
say no, never again.
And I say never say never again.
But watch my lips, never again.
Next year is the 40th anniversary of Ian Fleming. It's our last chance to do anything else. We're going to have a huge big barbecue and a summer party here with firework displays, the real business. We're definitely doing this.
We heard it first.
Okay.
Dave, thank you very much.
Oh dear. Wonderful. Cheers.
And he'll have to do it.
Thank you.
With that tempting thought, fans and officials alike changed for dinner that was to be held in the studio's magnificent restaurant. Each of the 10 dining tables were bedecked with balloons and named after Bond films, and the menu was good enough for 007 himself. Starting off with Dr. No's Delight, which consisted of potted crab. This was followed by Teehee's Temptation, a delicious chicken filled with brie. And for sweet, what could be sweeter than Tiffany's Truffles? All washed down with Bond Blend, a Blue Mountain Jamaica coffee, what else? But where was the Bollinger? Guests all received a limited edition crystal goblet engraved with the 30th anniversary logo, a box model of the new DB5, and an enamel tie-pin badge depicting one of the Bond film logos. With the meal eaten, it was now time for production designer Peter Lamont to share some stories about the many Bond films he had worked on, starting off with Thunderball.
One famous evening, we were doing the part where Bond had been swimming under the Disco Volante and found the underwater hold and was swimming away, but he's detected and they throw in hand grenades, and then they try to run him down between a huge catamaran called the Tropic Rover. Well, the idea is the speedboat goes over Bond, hits his tanks, Bond releases them, they're floating in the water, and Terrence said, well, that's great. Now we want them where they're fished out of the water and we see the damage of the tanks. Well, I don't know if you know that you just don't get a hammer onto a real scuba tank and can't dent it, because it's not quite like that. So I was working days in those at that time, but I happened to live in a hotel right up as Potter's portfolio doing this particular sequence. And I can remember going out and there was a huge row going on. Terrence said, okay, what do you mean we've only got one set of these? And there were these poor old fiberglass tanks we had. And Terrence said, well, all I wanted was to smash the top in. And I remember he got this hammer and he banged this damn tank. And it split like a damn banana. It looked absolutely ridiculous. He said, there we are, we're on a $6 million picture and we can't even get the tanks right. So I thought, Jesus Christ, you know, I can't let the other department down. So I remember I texted up these tanks, got a boat, went across the water to our workshop, put them together again, smashing holes in them, and made them look quite reasonable. When I came back, the row's still going on. It's now got to 7 million. So I said, I walked up, and Taylor said, well, that's what I damn well wanted in the first place. And the row ended there, and it all carried on.
Peter's next Bond was You Only Live Twice, where he was very closely involved with the construction of the volcano.
I remember people from United Artists coming when we started to have this big structural cover built over the set, which its scale was quite enormous. We had staunches which were 108 feet long, 33 by 11 and a half, and we had a span of over 200 feet. It was quite awe-inspiring, and we were 110 feet off the ground. And we had all these people over from United Artists. It was my part to take them over to show them what we were doing. And one of them said to me, he said, do you realize this set's costing more than Dr. No? And then they brought home, you know, the type of money that we were spending. Although again, we were still in the realms of reasonably cheap pictures. We were still not over the $8 million mark.
Honor Majesty's Secret Service brought its own particular headaches, especially the construction of Piz Gloria on the top of a mountain in Switzerland.
It's still there. Crazy things were done. We had to build a heliport. Sid was out there with a fellow called Hubert Froelich, and he had six Italians who were kind of labourers. How they did it, because everything had to be done by the cable railway. And I forget how much gravel, cement, that we've deeded right at the top of the ship, and we had a double ball because it went up. It came up on a cable railway up to Buren on the goods lift, but then it had to go up the normal cable car railway up to the Shieldhorn itself. And this was always done overnight. How they did it and the amount that they carried during those evenings is quite remarkable. And during that time, when they started to build it, they then started to transport the generator. That 2000 amp generator was taken to pieces and also taken up to the Shieldhorn. Well, I can remember sitting many years later with Dick Maybar, and he said, you know, Peter, he said, had Sean Connery been in on Her Majesty's Secret Service, it possibly been the best of all the pictures. Probably was the best story, and it was well set, and it was just one of those things. And there was a lot of dissent, as you remember, with George Lazenby. I don't remember even saying to him. I was with Peter Hunt one night, and he said, George, for God's sake, get one under your belt, then you've got something to negotiate about, you know. But it was a pity, because it was a great story, had a great Blofeld, there are other great actors in it, and it was a very enjoyable time.
After on Her Majesty's Secret Service, Peter won an Oscar for his work on Fiddler on the Roof, but was soon back in bondage on Diamonds Are Forever and Live and Let Die. Here Peter tells us of a scene that never made it into Live and Let Die.
Remember where Bond is being chased by, we think, Sheriff Pepper's brother, Billy Bob, and it's the Black Man. Well, we were going to do this sequence, and there was a place called, we used to call Miller's Bridge, and it was a swing bridge, and the idea there was going to be a big carnival, water carnival, was Bond howled through the whole of the. There was this big pyramid of skiers going through, Bond howls through, they all fall over, followed by Billy Bob, and this was followed by a black man, Eddie Jones, in another boat, had to swerve, went over the bridge, zoomed into the air, disappeared, and we pick it up where there's a fella just about to. Tee off and his golf, which was going to be Ted Moore, because he liked golf. Suddenly, as he's come on his backswing, there's this crash, and he looks around. There's this boat stuck in a bunker, and of course he bluffs his shot.
The Man with the Golden Gun produced one of the most spectacular and ambitious stunts in the series so far, namely the spiral jump. But the car used was no normal car.
The car actually had five wheels, it didn't have four, but there was a special ramp. When it had to hit that ramp at a certain speed to get the twist on, the fifth wheel then came into play, and as it swung over, it was then received on a ramp the other side. Well, came the day when it was done, we had two cars and there was a third car in reserve. A fellow called Bumps did the actual stunt. The car had been cut in half in America, widened by an inch and a half, everything had been centralised, was balanced, and Bumps duly hit the ramp at 40 miles an hour, and it went across just perfectly. The receiving ramp caught it, and the car actually drove away. And it was the first time that they'd ever done this stunt, the car had physically driven away. But there was an aftermath of this particular stunt, which again, we were very short of time. Cubby said to me some years later that his greatest regret was that when we were doing this stunt, he rather wanted the police then to do it in normal cars and see the whole meaning of crashing police cars, which we did.
The Spy Who Loved Me had Peter approaching Lotus in an effort to use the Esprit as the new James Bond car. But some people at Lotus had other ideas.
To sell you one at factory price. So I said, I'd not buy one. He said, they were certainly not giving you one. So I said, well, how about Romulus? And I really put them at some disadvantage because nobody had ever been to them and asked them to loan a car. Anyway, it was put to the chairman, which was called Colin Chapman, and he said, well, what can I say? But yes. So they said, what are your requirements? And the first thing I said that we wanted three bodies, and they became the basis of cars that Derek used out in the Bahamas. They were the first of the Esprit line, which was in effect not quite right with the specifications that were wanted.
Moonraker followed. Then on For Your Eyes Only, Peter was made production designer. Next up was Octopussy. It was during a flight out to the location in India that Peter found himself the real-life victim of a hijacking. As the plane landed and Peter awaited the outcome...
This hijacker allowed all the women to go near the front of the aircraft. He allowed the front door open, then he allowed the back door open. And this young American man in front of me said, look, if all the men could get up, you know, the captain would try and push him out the door. Anyway, everybody did get up and we were pushed back with his gun, but the captain did manage to get his arm back into the cockpit, get the fire axe, hit this fellow across the head, and he fell out of the door, swung the door frame as he went out, and then went straight out. Of course, there's the rat-tat-tat of gunfire and God knows what else. And the poor fellow ended up dead.
A View to a Kill was Roger Moore's last outing as Bond, but not for Peter. With a new Bond, Peter continued his role as production designer on Living Daylights and then on to License to Kill. As most of you will know, the film was shot in Mexico, and this was Peter's first reaction to this idea.
And this is not quite the studios there, they've got 8 stages. It's not quite like the studio. The facilities were zilch. Telephones didn't work. The stages were in bad repair. And so he said to me, well, if you don't do it in Mexico City, we're not doing it at all. So we went to Mexico City. And we did make it work. It was quite a lot of work. And it was an enjoyable time. I met a lot of people, especially the Mexican constructors. They do things not the way we do them, but I'm not about to teach them new ways, and it was an enjoyable sequence. And to bring the whole thing to a very rapid close, we did go there with a $36 million budget. We came in under schedule, under budget, and if there was another bomb, we'd want to go to Mexico quite a minute ago. Thank you very much for inviting me, and I hope I haven't bored you to death.
Thank you very much, Peter. Far from boring, because I think it really does, you know, when you talk about it like that, it does show the immense amount of work. Yeah, I can believe it. There's 3 books in you at least, right? The immense amount of work that goes into making a Bond film is absolutely colossal amount of work. And I only hope that when Bond number 17 does get off the ground, that it's more of a futuristic, possibly more fantastic plot. So that you get the chance of, you know, putting some of those ideas that I know that you've got in your head on the screen. And thanks for great for this. Right. It just remains me to say thank you very, very much indeed to all of our guests. You're turning it up. All of our guests have attended today, who I think added a great deal to the day. It would certainly have been as memorable a day without them, and I hope that you'll show your appreciation of the round of applause for everyone.
Another special guest was the late Vladek Sheybal, best remembered for his role as Kronsteen in From Russia with Love. He honoured us by cutting the 007 birthday cake. His talents will be deeply missed.
And I'd also like to say thank you to Graham for waking up this morning. No, sorry. I'd like to say thank you to all the people that have helped us, like Andrew, Lance, Julia, Rose, Lee, Tony. A round of applause, because they're the background people. We've had a good day, yes? Do we want to do this again?
No!
Because Graham doesn't want it, but I do. I think you've had a fabulous day. So I'm sure sometime next year we're going to do this again. So I'd just like to say it's a good night for me. Good night for me. Good night.
It certainly was a good night. In fact, the whole day was a great success. So as we look forward to the next James Bond feature, and of course the next 007 convention, we'll say goodbye from the James Bond 30th birthday party. So it seems.
one life for yourself and one for your dreams. You drift through the years and life seems to turn one dream appears and love is it. Don't